Doc, thank you for this wonderful meeting and to give me the opportunity to present this paper recently published in Annals of Internal Medicine. Rapidly, I recall you that all proteins inside the cells are degraded in the proteasome and cut in peptides, and these peptides meet the major histocompatibility complex in the reticulum, in the endoplasmic reticulum, and then are presented in the groove of the major histocompatibility complex, or HLA. And so we have two types, as you know, we have two types of HLA molecules. The class 1 HLA molecule exists on all the cells, and in the groove of this class 1 HLA, a particular family of peptide, not all peptide, but particular peptide are presented according to the polymorphism of HLA, and this peptide, which is immunopeptidome, is targeted by the cytotoxic T cells. And for the class 2, as you know, it's a presentation of the immunopeptidome to the helper cells to induce the immune response. It is a very old concept is the heterozygosity advantage, which was discovered 50 years ago by Zinkernagel and Doherty. And what is the heterozygosity advantage? If you each allele of HLA molecules is presented, is co-expressed, and if the patient is homozygous for one given locus, the immunopeptidome will be poorer, less complex, less rich than if the two alleles are different. And it has been shown that the more divergent were the two alleles, the greater was the immunopeptidome. And what is the HLA evolutionary divergence? Is simply the physicochemical divergence between the two alleles, which is calculated by an antique measure, the Grantham distance, very old measure, which is based on Peyer's comparison of amino acid. And in this example, with small differences between the two alleles, we can easily and immediately calculate the divergence, the physicochemical divergence between the two alleles. So, the more divergent are the two alleles, the richer, the more complex is the immunopeptidome, and this works for the donor and the recipients, and for class 1 and class 2. And we hypothesize that this divergence could be related to the allograft rejections. And, we studied two populations, a large adult population from Paul Bruce. As you know, all our patients have routine biopsies at 1, 2, 5, and 10 years following transplantation. And we had also the opportunity to study children from Necker Hospital. And these children also had a routine biopsy, and they also had the measurement of donor-specific antibody, which is not done in adults. So for each patient, we can define four HLA evolutionary divergence distance for the class 1, for the class 2, and for the donor and the recipients, and we search for association with histological lesions. And we studied that this possible association with a propensity score. The distribution of HLA is not normal, not at all. It runs between zero for the homozygote to a value of 15 for class 1 and 20 for class 2. Here you can see the cumulative incidence of different histologic lesions after liver transplantation in adults. We study acute rejection, chronic rejection, ductopenia, steatofibrosis, chronic hepatitis, cirrhosis, de novo autoimmune disease or plasma-rich rejections, biliary obstruction, regenerative hyperplasia, and also the venous occlusive disease in this population. For the propensity score, I will be quick. We consider different variables related to the histological lesions. And the most important result is that the donor HED class 1 was strongly related to acute rejection, to chronic rejection, but not to any other lesions. And in fact, this was mainly driven by the HED defined in the locus B, which is the most important for the rejection. And this was completely independent of the HLA compatibilities. It was stronger than the histocompatibility and all of the other variables involved. An interesting point that the other HED were not related to any lesions. The donor divergence class 1 was the only important variables for the prediction of rejection. In children, similar results. We have two types of major lesions, acute rejection and fibrosis, and the donor HED class 1 was significant and not the other HED. And this was independent of the presence of donor-specific antibodies in children. This is a classical representation with cumulative, actuarial Kaplan-Meier cumulative incidence of these lesions. Panel A, the donor class 1 for acute rejection. The IHED in green were associated to more acute and chronic rejections in adults and in children. Panel C show that the more the HED was high, the higher was the HED, the more intense was the ductopenia. And this suggests also that the intensity of ductopenia, which is equivalent to chronic rejections, was also driven by the donor HED. In conclusion, donor class 1 HED was associated to rejection, but not to other lesions. It was completely independent of the HLA compatibility between donors and recipients. Of all other variables related to rejection, young age, combined graft, HBV infection, and also of donor-specific antibodies at least in children. This is a completely new biomarker, only dependent of the donor, not of the matching, and we can apply this new biomarker before transplantation for the choice of the donor. In some occasions, we can refuse given a recipient and to wait for better recipients. And after liver transplantation, it can be very useful to guide the immunosuppression and to win the immunosuppression in patients receiving low HED donor. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Cyril. You should be congratulated because when we are doing liver transplantation, we know how difficult is to individualize one factor of the donor, of the recipient, of the procedure, and so on. And the very big originality of your study is to demonstrate that finally one single factor in a donor may be predictive, irrespective of the immunosuppression and irrespective of the HLA compatibility between donor and recipient. Yeah. So this is a strength of, of your study. Very, very important. Question from the floor?
Cyril, practically, according to the rule today of distribution of the donor, what do you propose? To change the rule?
Yes, we can discuss with regulatory authorities to introduce, maybe, this very easy biomarker. We have this marker, we know this marker since 15 years. It is completely free to calculate. The study did not cost, the cost of the study was zero. So we can have immediately this index, and we are in discussion with in France with a French agency to introduce this marker. I would like to say that it has been confirmed recently in a bone marrow transplantation, and we are studying this metric in the field of transplantation, and we have also in the field of vaccination, and we have also very interesting results. So a very old metric, a very old concept from the genius of immunology, Rolf Zinkel-Nagel, and a new application in the field in medicine, simply.
Okay, thank you. No more questions, no more comments. Thank you so much.